You only use 10% of your brain. Never start a sentence with a conjunction. Albert Einstein failed math in high school. There are a surprising number of urban myths and so-called common knowledge that turns out to be misinformation. Here are some lies they taught you in school. This feel-good story was practically shoved down U.S. students' throats during elementary school. The Pilgrims landed at Plymouth Rock, the land was inhospitable to the newcomers, and many of them starved. Luckily for the colonists, the indigenous people felt bad for them and taught them how to grow crops on unfamiliar soil. That way, they could share in a happy celebration. Though much of the story is technically true, it's often used as a sort of trick. The idea is to make children believe the early colonists shared a peaceful relationship with America's indigenous populations, and that is anything but the truth. There isn't much historical information about the first Thanksgiving in 1621 other than it happened and some Native allies were present. Otherwise, the mythologized events of the festival are generally accepted as truth by most Americans. But many indigenous Americans viewed the first Thanksgiving quite differently. It's common for people of Native heritage to hold a mourning fast over Thanksgiving. To them, the day marks a dark history filled with conflict, death, and other hardships they would not have encountered if Europeans hadn't started to colonize the Americas. Experts will likely agree that the English language is a mashup of several wildly different European languages clumped together, and the way the rules are taught to us in school doesn't make it any easier. That's mostly because these rules aren't actually rules at all. Take this piece of wildly believed grammar advice. You can't start a sentence with a conjunction. Most of us were conditioned to nix these short connecting words from a very early age. We were taught it, we believed it, and it's absolutely false. There's no single authority on the English language. As long as it does its job, namely conveying ideas from the writer to the reader, then whatever you decide to do with the words is acceptable. If you need an authority to tell you it's okay to start a sentence with and, but, or, you can check out Merriam-Webster. They say we've been breaking this rule since at least the 9th century. Similar to beginning a sentence with a conjunction, most of us were warned that ending a sentence with a preposition is another improper use of the English language. It's probably best to forget most of what you learned in high school English class, though. Language changes based on how it's used in everyday speech, and as we've seen with the internet lingo, it can even change overnight. There was certainly a time when ending a sentence with to, for, of, or with would have made you sound like uneducated street rabble, and that time has long since passed. These days, it's perfectly fine to end sentences with prepositions. It's simply an informal use of the language. You'll find it in virtually all written and spoken media. Frankly, if you go around declaring of which or to which, you'll sound overly formal and even somewhat awkward. You've heard it 1,000 times. You only use 10% of your brain. The phrase seems to suggest that there's a trove of hidden brain power that could turn us into superhumans if we could tap into it.
It's true. Once the brain reaches 20%, it opens up and expands the rest. There are no more obstacles. They fall away like dominoes.
The whole idea, however, is a myth. If you only use 10% of your gray matter, you probably wouldn't be capable of reading an article or tying your shoes. Luckily for you, our species is capable of harnessing a lot more of the brain's power than we were told. According to neurologist Dr. John Henley of the Mayo Clinic, people use close to 100% of their brains throughout the day. At the lowest, we might be using 10% of our brains at any given time, but even that's unlikely since the brain controls such a wide range of functions, both conscious and unconscious. It has designated areas for everything, from language to math, to basic life support functions such as keeping your heart beating. Only using 10% of it would make it impossible to breathe, walk, and talk on the phone without falling over dead. The 10% brain power excuse might help us feel better about forgetting why we walked into the kitchen 3 times in a row, but the truth is, we have a much larger percentage of our brains to blame for our absent-minded behavior. Slavery is one of the worst atrocities the United States has ever known, and the full history of abolition isn't widely understood. For example, and contrary to popular belief, slavery didn't end in the United States with President Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation in 1863. The proclamation did free slaves, but only in Confederate-controlled states. People in Union states where slavery was legal were still allowed to keep slaves. This is in part because Lincoln didn't want to alienate them and provide more potential allies for the rebels. Slavery mostly ended with the passing of the 13th Amendment in 1865, which outlawed both slavery and involuntary servitude in all forms. This is minus a glaring loophole that's still taken advantage of today. According to the language used in the amendment, involuntary servitude is still allowed as long as it's punishment for a crime. Unfortunately, we've seen this tradition live on through prison labor. Many historians partially blame the loophole for the booming prison industry in the United States, one that disproportionately incarcerates black Americans. One night in 1752, Benjamin Franklin decided it was a brilliant idea to take a key, a bit of string, and a kite and sail it all through the tumultuous air of a thunderstorm. Franklin was on a scientific mission he didn't know would go down in mythic history as the discovery of electricity. But this famed experiment didn't lead to the discovery of electricity at all, despite what people have wrongly claimed for years. Electricity wasn't exactly a new concept in Franklin's time. The world had known about it for centuries, even if they didn't yet know how to utilize it. The ancient Greeks ran experiments with static electricity. Ancient clay pots containing iron rods and copper cylinders were found in Baghdad in the 1940s. They appear to have been early batteries, suggesting that parts of the world may have been able to harness electricity before others knew it existed. Franklin's experiment served its purpose, though. The Founding Father wasn't setting out to discover electricity. Instead, he wanted to demonstrate the electrical nature of lightning, which the experiment illustrated perfectly. Considered one of the wonders of human ingenuity, the Great Wall of China was one of the longest construction projects in history, both in physical length and length of time. It's so long that many of us were told that it's visible from space. This is a complete myth. Even with the best possible human vision, a person couldn't actually see the Great Wall from outer space. This myth is so widely believed, it's made its way into textbooks. Some even claim the wall is visible from Earth's moon, which is even more of a stretch. The truth is, you can't even see the wall from the International Space Station with the naked eye. Though, to be fair, it doesn't take a whole lot of work to bring it into view from there. A Chinese astronaut was able to photograph the wall with a 180mm and 400mm camera lens while on the ISS. Experts say, however, that the wall was only visible because the photos were taken under perfect conditions. The structure is no wider than a house and is of a similar color to its surroundings. Many of us remember hearing our teachers tell us to put our hats on before we go outside in the winter. After all, you lose most of your heat from the top of your head. None of us thought to refute it, but once again, this is another lie. The whole losing more heat through your head thing is nothing more than a popular myth. It likely cemented itself into society through a 1970s survival manual published for the US Army. It claimed in one line that you lose 40 to 45% of body heat from an uncovered head, and from there, the myth spread like a disease. In a lucky break for hatless children everywhere, two researchers at Indiana University published a study on medical myths in 2008 and totally debunked this lie. Now, they do say you're more likely to notice cold temperatures on your head and face because of the plethora of nerve endings in the area, so you'll likely be more comfortable wearing a hat in the winter, but it's not a health crisis if you don't. Physics isn't the easiest subject to get young people interested in, but it is important. Physics is a unique subject, as it's the field that studies the rules of our existence. A common way teachers try to get kids to pay attention in these somewhat dry classes is with lighthearted anecdotes. A classic example being the famous story about Sir Isaac Newton and the apple. It goes something like this. Newton was lounging against the apple tree in his mother's garden when one of the fruits fell and bonked him on the head. This sudden blow sparked inspiration, and Newton conceptualized gravity. Except that's not how it went down. Gravity wasn't a new concept to Newton. He thought about the subject long before the falling apple. Better yet, there's no evidence suggesting the falling apple ever hit him. In fact, all accounts that claim the apple sparked Newton's insight into gravity are secondhand at best. Even if the anecdote were true, it only influenced a small part of his theory, and it certainly didn't happen instantaneously. The majority of Newton's fascination with gravity stemmed from his interest in the moon's orbit around the Earth. Some of the lies we learned were simple informational blunders, while others seemed to be more benevolent falsities. Those white lies, whether believed or not, serve a purpose. For example, we have a famous and totally false anecdote about Albert Einstein. The inventor of the theory of relativity was supposedly a poor student in high school. He allegedly performed so badly in math that he actually failed the subject.
I still failed the math test!
You do have Einstein's genius or some junk. I just forgot to tell you that when Einstein was a kid, he flunked math too.
Of course, this never happened. The truth is that Einstein was a fantastic student who excelled from a young age in just about every subject he studied. The only known time where he failed was during his first crack at taking the entrance exam for Zurich Polytechnic. He only failed the exam because the exam was in French, a language he wasn't very familiar with. Regardless of whether or not Einstein failed math doesn't affect the usefulness of the myth. Though it may lose teachers some perceived integrity later in a student's life, the anecdote tells children that even if they fail now, they can succeed later on. It's easy to see why one may think deoxygenated blood is blue. If you have a pale complexion where your veins are easily visible, they appear blue-green through your skin. And except for the pulmonary veins, veins carry deoxygenated blood. Therefore, deoxygenated blood is blue, right? That at least seems to be the sort of false logic that led to this myth spreading. Throughout school and in every diagram of the circulatory system, we see this. But in reality, all blood is red, whether they're in arteries or veins. Blood is never blue, regardless of its level of oxygenation. Oxygen-rich hemoglobin makes blood appear a brighter red than deoxygenated cells, but it isn't a drastic enough change to shift blood to a different color. So why do blood and veins appear blue from the outside when visible? The false color comes from several variables, but basically, red light is absorbed by lighter skin tones while blue light is reflected. Bats' abilities to perceive the world around them is practically a superpower compared to humans' limited sensory capabilities. Their big ears capture reflected squeaks and clicks to create a detailed sonic map that allows them to avoid obstacles and catch tasty mosquitoes. Sonar is pretty useful when you're nocturnal, especially if we're to believe that bats are blind. But they aren't. This lie has been wrongfully taught everywhere for as long as most of us can remember. The myth has pervaded society deeply enough to give rise to phrases such as blind as a bat, but idioms don't have the power to make misinformation true. In all actuality, bats don't just have super hearing, they also have incredible light-dark vision, which is 3 times better than human vision. Bats can see in conditions humans consider pitch black. This is really the only type of vision they need, and it's also the only vision of theirs that's any good. It's a perfect adaptation to their nocturnal evolution. But what bats gain in light-dark vision, they lose in color sharpness. The bottom line? Bats aren't blind, they just can't see well during the day. Your mothers, grandmothers, and of course your teachers probably warned you about spending too much time out in the cold. This is especially true if it was both cold and wet, because you'll catch a cold from being cold. Of course, that's not how any of this works. The common cold is usually caused by a rhinovirus or a similar culprit. The human body obviously doesn't create a virus out of exposure to winter weather. Viral infections are more common during winter months for a plethora of reasons that have nothing to do with your body temperature. For instance, low humidity allows viruses to live longer outside of a host. People spend more time in poorly ventilated indoor environments during the winter months, and the protective mucus inside of your throats and sinuses becomes drier and more easily infected. The list goes on. There is a kernel of truth to this lie, though. Lowered body temperature wreaks havoc on the immune system and makes you more susceptible to infectious disease. Where winter weather isn't going to give you a virus by itself, it still has real consequences on the human body if you don't dress properly for outside temps. The only health issues you're likely to find as a direct result of those cold temperatures, though, are frostbite and hypothermia. In the United States, students have been taught proper dietary nutrition through the USDA food pyramid since 1992. In the first iteration of the pyramid, people were expected to eat an extremely grain-heavy diet while avoiding all forms of fats and oils. At least it does allow for some vegetables and up to 6 combined servings of meats and dairy as well. Eventually, even the USDA realized this wasn't a healthy way to fuel our bodies, so they replaced the classic pyramid with My Pyramid in 2005. The new pyramid added activity into the mix and focused more on helping individuals tailor a healthy diet unique to them. But it was heavy on carbs and milk while demonizing all fats. This too, as it turns out, isn't great. The line on details dietary advice in all forms of the USDA pyramid leaves out too much to be a useful guide, and it focuses too heavily on foods that are only good for humans in moderation. There's more than enough evidence to show that you can maintain great health while eating a low-carb diet. Fats like omega-3s shouldn't be avoided, and your sodium intake is important. While the dietary information housed in USDA graphics certainly means well, modern evidence suggests the pyramids don't know what they're talking about. You're better off keeping up with the latest research. Despite what Edison enthusiasts may want you to believe, Thomas Edison didn't invent the light bulb. The first person to successfully light up a filament with electricity was an English chemist by the name of Humphrey Davy around the turn of the 19th century. He ran current through a high-resistance wire, and there was light. But his design was nothing more than a fancy science fair project. There was no way his thick wire would have been efficient on an industrial scale. Then came Warren De La Rue. He took the wire idea, but made it of a thin, high-endurance metal and stuffed it into a vacuumed glass. By doing this, he created a light bulb almost 40 years before Edison. La Rue's bulb, like Davy's, would never be produced on a large scale, mostly because the filament was made of platinum. Still, though Thomas Edison didn't invent the light bulb, he did create the best light bulb of his time. Edison's design used a thin carbon filament and created a better vacuum than LaRue's design, providing the light bulb with both longevity and commercial producibility. He may have not been the first person to invent the light bulb, but Edison's company is the reason we have electric lighting in our homes. We're taught in basic science classes that there are only three states of matter: solid, liquid, and gas. We learned it first with the water vapor and ice cubes experiments in elementary school, and it's a fact that's stuck with most of us ever since. But that education is an oversimplification, and it erased several less prevalent states of matter from popular knowledge. There are twice as many states of matter than we were initially taught, though you're only likely to encounter the basic three here on Earth. The fourth state of matter, known as ionized plasma, occurs when atoms are pumped with enough energy to strip away their electrons. This breaks the gaseous threshold to form a whole new state that behaves by different rules. The fifth and sixth states of matter, to our knowledge, have only been created under laboratory conditions. They're known as Bose-Einstein and fermionic condensates. Bose-Einstein condensates occur when a collection of bosons, a unique type of subatomic particle, are cooled to their lowest energy state. Fermionic condensates, meanwhile, occur when fermions, another type of subatomic particle, reach their lowest energy state and create a superfluid. It would take a major crash course in quantum physics to really understand these states further. When you visit the zoo, one order of animal stands above the rest, the primates. They look suspiciously like us. Why shouldn't they? We are, after all, hairless great apes. We just happen to stand straighter, and some of us are smarter than our tree-climbing cousins. You were probably told in school, as most of us were, that we evolved from apes like the gorilla or the chimpanzee. But that's not exactly how evolution works.
He is now in the custody of the Ministry of Science.
Take your stinking paws off me, you damn dirty ape!
About 6 million years ago, proto-humans and apes set off on divergent evolutionary paths. We have yet to find any physical evidence of a single common ancestor, but based on genetic evidence, there should be one trapped in the fossil record somewhere. What scientists can see from tracing back our evolutionary history confirms that this ancestor was indeed ape-like. While the claim about humans evolving from apes is partially true, it's widely misunderstood. The truth is that humans and the other modern apes share a common primate ancestor that was neither human nor anything like modern apes. Until we find the missing link, it'll be impossible to say for sure if this creature was an ape or some sort of proto-ape deserving of its own classification. So don't take to those trees just yet. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more grunge videos about your favorite stuff are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.